Hi, my name is Sebastian Stabinger. I am doing my PhD with Antonio Rodriguez Sanchez from the Intelligent and Interactive Systems Research Group at the Department of Computer Science. And today I'm going to talk to you about deep learning for abstract classification tasks. First, I'm going to give a quick introduction into deep learning and what the goal of my PhD actually is. Then I will talk about finding flaws in deep learning systems. And then I will present a theoretical framework that tries to explain those flaws. So what is deep learning? Deep learning is a subfield of machine learning, which again is a subfield of artificial intelligence. And the idea of machine learning is that instead of programming a solution to a problem yourself, you show a system examples of solutions, and the system learns on its own how to solve those problems. And since around 10 years ago, deep learning is the most prominent method in machine learning. And if you've heard about artificial neural networks before, then deep learning is basically the modern form of that. Now, what is an artificial neuron and how does it work? It's actually quite simple. You can imagine this sum and f here to be the artificial neuron, and it's doing nothing else but calculating a weighted sum over its inputs. So you have an input that's multiplied by a weight, and all of those products are summed up, and the sum is then sent through a nonlinear function, which is usually called the activation function. And then the output of this function is sent either to other neurons as input, or at the end of the neural network, then this is used as the output of this neural network. And you might imagine that all the magic is happening in this activation function, but those functions are usually very, very simple. Nowadays, it's very common to use something called a rectified linear unit, which just means you calculate the maximum of the value in zero. So you're basically just capping the values at zero, each negative value gets zero, and all other values are just passed through without any change. For an artificial neural network, you generally combine many such artificial neurons into a bigger network, hence the name. So the output of one neuron will become the input of multiple other neurons. And generally, networks like those are organized around so-called layers, and layers are usually neurons that are in parallel, so they are not connected to each other in some way, but they receive input from a previous layer and pass their output to the next layer. And in this case, you can imagine this like this. On the left side, we have the first layer that actually receives the input to this network. Then the information flows to the right. And at some point, you have neurons that don't pass their information along to other neurons, and those are the output neurons. How would a solution of this dog and cat detector actually look like? What we want to have is a neural network that has two output neurons that we designate as the dog and the cat neuron. And if we send in the pixel values of an image that contains a dog into the input of this network, we want to have the dog neuron to have a very high output. And if we send in a picture of a cat, then we want the cat neuron to have very high output. Now, this neural network is basically just a giant formula of weighted sums and those nonlinear functions. So to achieve this, we have to set the weights of all the neurons to have exactly this behavior. Now, those networks are a lot bigger than what is shown here. Usually, we are in the range of millions of weights for smaller networks to quite commonly hundreds of millions of weights to really big, especially language models that can have multiple trillions of weights. So of course, those weights can't be set by hand. So we have to have some automatic procedure that does that. And this is done using optimization procedures. Nowadays, neural networks are almost exclusively trained using stochastic gradient descent together with backpropagation. Unfortunately, I don't really have time to go into detail of that, but the main principle is as follows. We show an image to our network, and the network will produce some output. And if it's not trained, usually for two classes, the outputs of the two neurons will be approximately the same. But we know what the actual output should be. So we know it should be a dog and it should not be a cat. And we use a so-called loss function that takes the output of the neuron and the expected output and generates a so-called loss. And our goal in our optimization problem is to reduce this loss. So the idea is we show the image of a dog, and since we have a loss, we can calculate a gradient over the weights. So we know in which direction we have to adjust the weights so that the loss gets smaller for this concrete instance. And we do this, and then if we show the image again, we have a slightly smaller loss. And we do that for all images, so usually in the order of a few 10,000 of images. And we do this over and over. So we do these steps, these stochastic gradient descent steps, millions, billions of times. And at the end, we have a neural network that not only gives the correct output for the images that we have trained on, but surprisingly, it actually generalizes and it is able to detect dogs and cats in our case, even with images it hasn't seen before, even for images that shows dogs in different poses that it might not have seen before, in different lighting conditions, on different backgrounds and things like that. So what was the goal of my PhD? Deep learning is actually extremely successful in solving many image classification tasks, and people actually started to claim that they generally surpass humans when it comes to image classification. My intuition was that this is actually not the case in general, but only for these very concrete classification tasks where you have to detect some concrete objects like cats and dogs or differentiating planes from cars and things like that. But you can come up with a lot of more abstract classification tasks that are also built on images. And my goal was to find or construct data sets that are easy to solve for humans, but that deep learning systems struggle with, and to explain why this might be the case. And after searching for quite some time for data sets that reveal some weird behavior of deep learning systems, I stumbled upon the synthetic visual reasoning test by Fleuret and colleagues. And what does this data set consist of? It has 23 different problems, which are all image-based, and the goal is always to classify the images into one of two classes. And the idea is they all contain these very abstract outlines. And these outlines or these shapes either follow a rule or don't follow a rule. And the goal is to classify them whether they follow the rule or not. So in this example, you have for one class, it's always two shapes. And for one class, the two shapes that are shown are identical. And for the other class, the two shapes are not identical. Or another example, you have two shapes again. Both are always identical up to scaling, but for one class, the two shapes are inside of each other, and in the other instance, they are outside of each other. Now, this dataset was originally developed to test machine learning systems and compare them against humans. And humans are actually quite good at learning to solve these tasks. And also the machine learning systems that were tested at that time performed reasonably well on those problems and on this data set. And I was actually the first one to test deep learning systems on this data set. And I was able to show that deep learning systems have some difficulty with a certain subset of problems of this data set. So if we compare the performance of humans here in orange and of a deep learning system here in blue, and we look at the problems, and here problems that need comparison of shapes to be able to solve the problem are colored in red, and ones that don't need this are colored in blue. And if you look at this graph for the humans, it doesn't really make much of a difference whether you have to compare shapes or not. And that's also what Fleury showed in his original paper. So with different machine learning systems, it also doesn't really make much of a difference. But for deep learning systems, you can see that for problems that need comparison, deep learning performs very poorly. There's one exception here, the number 8, where I could also show that here the data is actually generated in a not ideal way. So that's actually not really that the system compares anything here. That's basically just using extraneous features to solve this problem. So that was basically the first glimpse that I had that there seems to be really a fundamental flaw with deep learning systems to solve certain data sets. We were able to publish these preliminary results in a paper, and then this very specific dichotomy of the problem sets that can be solved and not at ICANN. And by now, this also has been replicated for the SVOD dataset and for other datasets by multiple other research groups. Since the SVRD dataset shows very unrealistic images, I created the next dataset myself. I call it the chess dataset. And the chess dataset always shows chess boards with red pawns on them. And for the similarity task, the goal is to decide whether the positioning of the pawns on one chessboard is the same as on the other one. And there are different difficulties of this dataset. So the easiest one is with a fixed camera position where the chessboards are always in the same position from the same angle. And the most difficult one is with random camera positioning on a sphere. So the camera can be positioned around the sphere, around the chessboard. So there's a lot of variation in the angles that you can see the chessboards from. That's the similarity task. And as a second task, there's the symmetry task where there's always only one chessboard. And the goal is to detect whether the pawn positioning is symmetric along a symmetry axis. Again, with different orders of difficulty depending on how variable the camera positioning can be and so forth. And the results on this dataset replicate what we have seen on the SVRD dataset. Both of these problems are not trivial to solve for deep learning systems, but the similarity task is a lot more difficult than the symmetry task. And we were able to publish this at CVPR. In cognitive psychology, it is usually assumed that humans use so-called concepts to classify objects. And there is three big groups of concepts called perceptual concepts, associative concepts, and relational concepts. And I was able to make a connection between deep learning and concept learning. And I showed that perceptual concepts is something that deep learning can solve very easily. Associative concepts is something that has not been studied a lot, but there is quite some evidence that neural networks learn associative concepts automatically, implicitly, and that relational concepts is actually where deep learning systems have some problems, not with all of those concepts, but with some of them. And relational concepts are exactly concepts where you have to put objects, concrete instances of objects in relation to each other, like, for example, the similarity relation where you have to compare two objects. And after looking at quite a lot of data sets, experiments with data sets and animal experiments and human experiments, I came to the conclusion that there's two things that deep learning systems need to be able to solve these relational concepts efficiently. And number one is attention is needed. And attention basically means that you're able to focus your resources, your compute resources, onto specific parts of the input. And number two, that some form of iterative processing is needed so that you can do something over and over and use the information from previous iterations in the next iterations. And some eye tracking experiments of a master student that I supervised was able to show that for the datasets that I've shown you previously, if humans solve those, then we could show that they do use attention and they do use iterative processing. So they switch between the two objects and compare them this way. And we were able to publish all of this at the Journal of Vision. You might ask yourself, why is it even important to learn relational concepts? And it's all about learning efficiency. Imagine that you're in a forest and you see two trees, and those two trees are more similar to each other than to the other trees. Then you can go to one of those trees, learn something about it by interacting with it, and then transfer this knowledge you have gained to the other tree without having to actually interact with it. And if you think about robots in the world, then it's, I think, quite clear that robots will also be able to have to learn things like that. Until now, I was only able to give experimental evidence why I thought that attention and iterative processing was important. But I also wanted to have a theoretical framework which explains why relational tasks seem to be difficult and why attention and iterative processing might be helpful. And to be able to construct this theoretical framework, I also came up with a very easy task, a very easy data set. I call it the identity task. And the goal here is we have different amount of patches that are just black and white pixels. And the goal is to decide whether at least half of the patches are identical or not. So in this case, three are identical out of five, so they are identical. or in this case, only 2 out of 5 are identical, so this would be the non-identical class. Unfortunately, I don't really have time to go into detail of this abstract framework that I constructed, but the result was that I showed that the most optimal thing a deep learning system can do is to transfer this image patch comparison problem into the problem of deciding whether at least half of the numbers of a list of numbers are identical or not. Surprisingly, this number-based problem is essentially as difficult for deep learning systems to solve as the original image-based problem. But a very interesting insight I had was that if you sort this list of numbers, suddenly this task becomes very easy to solve for deep learning systems. And intuitively, it makes sense because if the list is unsorted, you basically have to compare all pairs of numbers to be able to decide whether half of the numbers are identical or not. But if the list is sorted, then if a number is identical, all those identical numbers will appear in a block in this list. So it is essentially enough to just look at pairs of numbers. So I have shown that this identity task can basically be solved by sorting. And the very nice thing about sorting is that in computer science, a lot is known about sorting. So there's a lot of theoretical research on the complexity of sorting and things like that. And there's a concept called sorting networks, which is basically a mathematical idea of an abstract network, which has nothing to do with neural networks, it's a completely different idea, that can be used to sort numbers. And a lot of theoretical research, especially on the lower bounds of the complexity of such networks, exists. And I want to transfer this from sorting networks to neural networks. And I came up with an algorithm that takes sorting networks and uses it to construct a neural network that is able to also sort numbers. And this allows me now to take theoretical results on sorting networks and basically apply them to neural networks that are sorting numbers. So how does all of this relate to the two hypotheses that I proposed previously, that we need attention and iterative processing? Regarding attention, the picture looks like this. Without attention, we don't really know which positions are patches and which positions are park patch, park background, and just background. So in essence, for our abstract problem, this means that we have a lot of numbers that we have to sort and process. With attention, we know which positions contain patches, so the amount of numbers we have to sort and process is much smaller. And using the lower bounds on sorting networks and then on neural networks, I come up with the amount of weights that are needed without attention for an image of 224 by 224 pixels comes down to 65.3 billion weights, which is not unheard of for neural networks, but for such a simple problem is quite extreme. And with attention, we can greatly reduce this to 18.4 million weights, which is but still quite a lot for such a simple task. So how does iterative processing relate to all of this? The idea here is that we can send the list of numbers through a neural network, take the output and send it again through the same network and do that multiple times. And if we're allowed to do this, the sorting network that we can use is much, much simpler, and we are able to reduce the number of weights we need without attention to 26.1 billion, with attention to 7.3 million weights. And if we are allowed to do something akin to double iterative processing, where we can have a small network that is applied in sequence to pairs of numbers, then we can actually solve this with just 12 weights, showing that iterative processing seems to be really important to keep the number of weights down. A colleague and I were also able to show that all these theoretical lower bounds that I presented actually hold in practice when you really try to learn all those tasks from data. And all those results we were able to publish at neural networks. At least for the attention mechanism, other research groups by now were able to show that if you implement an attentional mechanism into deep learning, you're actually able to solve datasets like the SVRD dataset a lot better. So the networks perform a lot better on it, which at least seems to support my first hypothesis that attention is something that is really important. As I've already mentioned during the talk, all of the research I've presented is already published, and I hope that you enjoyed the talk and you use the forum to ask questions. Thank you.